first Norwegian national team that competed at a Nordic Barista Cup in 2003. Today, he owns his own little roastery and espresso bar and school in Oslo. And he's won the World Barista Championship. He's won the World Cup Tasting Championship. He is now also a part of Nordic Approach, and he's going to talk to us now about sourcing quality coffee. Tim Wendelboe.
All right. Can you hear me? Yeah? I figured out I have 15 minutes more than on the schedule, which is good because I have almost 80 slides and a video. And that's a little bit hard to do in 30 minutes, so 45 is better. In my opinion, the biggest potential for raising quality in a coffee shop is in the field, is where the coffee is grown. That's where we haven't done any experiments in terms of quality. Right? I think so. Most researchers I've been talking to for my last 5 years, most farmers have been researching coffee in terms of production and resistance, not in terms of quality. The only research that I know being made by farmers in terms of improving quality is planting new varieties, improving process a little bit. And as I talked with James about yesterday evening, well, afternoon, nobody's working with the soil. There's a lot of organic farmers around. They don't really know what they're doing. They're just told what to do. Nobody's researching it in terms of quality and taste. That's one of the things that I'm working on now, and I'm very passionate about. Because I think we've pretty much nailed how to brew coffee, and I'm sure David Walsh will disagree with me, but I don't think we can improve the green coffee that we're buying a whole lot more with different brewing. Maybe we can increase 2-3% in terms of quality, but not a huge amount. In the field, I think we can improve the quality. I mean, there's no limits to what we can do. There are probably 4,000 varieties that exists, or maybe more, I don't know, of Arabica. And we're commercially growing around 200 of them. If you ask Senecafe in Colombia, they have 800 Arabicas in their demonstration plot. If you ask them what they taste like, they have no idea. One of the things I ask myself when I open my coffee shop, am I buying specialty coffee? Because I figured I had a Santa Alina farm from Brazil that I had been buying. And I noticed that Friele, one of our biggest roasters in Norway, had the coffee from the same farm. And I was wondering, what makes the difference? And I cupped it. There wasn't a big difference. How can consumers know that this is special and this is not when there's no difference? So for me, sourcing from the very start of my roastery, it's part of my quality control. Sourcing for me is not asking different roasters, can I get a bag of coffee and tasting it. Sourcing for me is getting to the source of where the coffee is grown, making sure the product is good. I'm going to talk a lot about Colombia today, and one of the biggest issues I've had with coffee was from Colombia. I bought 60 bags of a very good lot. When it arrived to Norway, it tasted like Malabar. I lost a lot of money on that. So, just to get it going, I'm going to talk about two different projects today. One is about drying experiments. I've been doing a lot of experiments on drying coffee. And the second part is about my project in Colombia, which is at a farm called Finca Tamala. Let's talk about drying. You can taste the two cups that is in front of you. Taste a little bit. Thank you. I know they're a little bit cold. Can you taste the difference? Yeah? Oh, it's the same coffee. It's exactly the same coffee. The one in the white cup, for me, tastes a little pulpy, tastes a little woody, right? The one in the red cup, cleaner, tastes fresh. This is harvested last year, in June. Both of them. The white one is dried in the sun. The red one is dried in the shade. This is at Fazenda Ambiental Fortaleza in Mococa, Brazil. It's a natural coffee, so dried with the pulp and skin. This is the white cup. This is from the red cup. Same coffee, picked on the same day. Everything is the same. We cupped it in Vienna this year, and people were amazed that it's the same coffee, because when you cup it, it's even more pronounced. The one in the sun tastes really fermenty and woody, and the one dried in the shade tastes clean and like a fresh coffee. The conclusion is, drying affects quality, right? And back to the Colombian coffee that I bought that tasted like Malabar when it arrived. This is the issue. Beans look like this if they're dried too fast or improperly. They arrive and they look like this. They can look good when they leave the origin country, and the average moisture can be 11%, but it doesn't tell you how the coffee was dried just by measuring the average moisture. Some of these beans might be at 8%, some of them might be at 12%. And you mix those together and you make a coffee, and of course the overdried will taste woody, and the underdried will taste a little strange. I started experimenting with drying because of this Colombian coffee, for sure, but also what really triggered it was in Honduras, I think it was 2009. I was there to see how producers were producing coffee, and I noticed that one of my competitors and also colleagues had been buying coffee that had been dried like this from a farm. This is a solar dryer, it's a drying bed covered in plastic. And when you walked inside there, it was almost 60 degrees, and there was water dripping from the ceiling. It's like a sauna, right? The coffee from the farm that I've been buying was just dried on normal patios. Took about 10 days to dry. This took 2 days to dry. Coffee arrived to Norway, shipped in the same container, stored in the same storage. This coffee tasted like monsoon Malabar. My coffee was fresh for another 6 months. Interesting, huh? So, I'm sure you know these guys. They're sitting up there. For those of you who don't know them, these are my favorite farmers, Marisabel and Moises. They have a lot of farms in Honduras, in Marcala, and they were kind enough to let me go bananas in their farms. So, because I wanted to help them, I want to help them improve the quality of their coffee. So we've been doing a drying experiment there. Because they have a big mill, they have around 200 hectares of land with coffee. And they have a big mill where you can actually do many different processes and drying techniques. So we decided to do one coffee, traditionally dried on the patio, one in the Guardiola, which is a drying machine, one in a raised bed with a plastic cover, that I call the greenhouse, should call it a sauna. One in a raised African bed, like in the sun, like they do in Africa, and one raised bed in the shade, like they do at Faf in Brazil. Before we started, we have to sort of try to nail down what's the purpose of drying the coffee. Why are we doing it? And of course, the first thing is to get the moisture content down. We want it to be like around 11%, so it doesn't mold when it gets transported and so on. And of course, we want to control temperature. If you read books like written many years ago, they all state that if you dry coffee in too hot conditions, you will break the cell structure of the beans. You might get a very hard surface of the bean if it's hot in the beginning. So the moisture is not actually able to escape very efficiently. So high temperatures is not good for drying. So I made an Excel spreadsheet. I gave Marisabel and Moises a moisture meter. And we did something very simple, manual data logging. So every day, except the first day because it was raining, we measured the temperature of the air in the atmosphere, the temperature of the parchment, so the actual coffee, and also the moisture content. Of course, these are a little random numbers. You will see like every evening, it's a little drier than the next morning because, of course, the coffee gets a little bit more moisture overnight. These are all the data. Can we give a hand for all the data? Huh? Pretty good. A little bit hard to analyze if you're not very into drying. So I'll take you through it very simply. Basically, the patio is, in my opinion, the worst place to dry coffee. Chickens, they go and shit on the coffee. People step on the coffee. When it rains, it gets wet. The parchment looks dirty. It cracks. It's impossible to control the temperature because in the high sun, it will get very hot coffee and so on. You'll taste this afterwards. These are the three raised beds. The greenhouse I already talked about. The greenhouse can be good, but most people use them wrong. You're supposed to open the sides and have a good air circulation so that the coffee don't get too moist and too hot. But most farmers, they want to dry it quickly because that means cash fast. They need money now. That's because we're not paying them good enough for coffee. Raised bed, like in Africa, works pretty well in Africa, right? Except when it's really sunny, they seem to forget to cover it. Or they say, in Kenya, they say, we cover the coffee at the hottest point of the day. And I found out the reason. It's because everyone goes to have lunch. So they just cover the coffee, and then we come back, they open it again. But what if it's hot after that, you know? The shade one, so far in the raised beds, giving very interesting results. A little bit easier to control temperature, especially the maximum temperature, because you can lower the temperature a little bit. This is one of the problems with the raised bed in the sun. You will see that a lot of the parchment cracks, and then you can get the coffee is like a sponge, so it will, if you have like a diesel car next to it, it will suck up some of that fumes, and so on. And I expect this to taste worse than the shade dried because the parchment in the shade dried does not crack at all. So it's completely intact. Here's how it is. This is the Guardiola. It's basically a roaster with a perforated drum, but it roasts the coffee on very low temperatures. Again, in my theory, this can be very good because you can control the temperature, so you don't have to dry it on a very high temperature. The most farmers, again, throw it in there, boost it up, dry it in one day, get it out, money in the pocket. At Caballeros, we dried it for 6 or 7 days. We had some power outs, and it's a little hard to control because it's a wood-fired oven, so it doesn't have a digital thermostat. Yeah, this is the temperature we're drying at, quite low. So in theory, if you look at it, the big fat red line is the Guardiola. Quite stable, same temperature. The green one is the raised bed in the sun. It's all over the place. And of course, the one in the shade takes a lot longer time. Up to 30 days in Colombia to dry the coffee. That's 3 times more than is usual on a patio, which means you have to pay for the worker to move the coffee. You don't get the money in your pocket when you need it, and so on. So in theory, the Guardiola looks like the best option, right? We're going to taste it afterwards to see if it is, because it's not every time that theory is right. All right, so we'll taste 4 of these coffees afterwards, after the lecture. Blind, of course, so you can see what you like. And these were harvested in January, so I'm not expecting to see the big difference now, but like in 2-3 months, we will see even more and more development in the coffees that are dried on patio. I'm expecting to be more and more woody, while the one in the shade will still taste fresh. So, How many read my blog? Raise your hands. Oh, that's pretty good. Have you read about this project? Okay, so we're done now. Finca Tamala is located in a mountain range in Huila, in Colombia. I used to buy coffee from there, from a farmer, a farm called Finca La Lomita. Very nice coffee. The farmer, unfortunately, ran away with his wife's sister. Opened a hardware store and abandoned the farm. So, yeah, this is the farmhouse. First time I was in Colombia, I met this guy. He looks a little bit like Maradona, right? He's called Elias. We visited him in Primaveral, in Acevedo, right? Very nice guy. He's a leader of a growing group. Very humble, eager to learn. Always there when I'm in Colombia. I've never bought coffee from him. And there's only one reason for it. It's never been very good. It's been over-fermented, or over-dried, or something like that. But this guy, he's smart enough, so he's been buying land in a very different way. He didn't pay for it. He paid for it with the coffee that was already on the trees. So he took the land and so on. But he got the farm next to the La Lomita that I used to buy from. 60 hectares of land, where about 20 hectares is with coffee. And he basically just jumped into it and started working the farm. I met him, I think it was last year or 2 years ago, right after he got the farm. And we started talking, and I wanted to sort of rent a plot on the farm to do experiments, crazy experiments, like go fully organic, pick flowers off the tree so they don't get cherries, and so on. Sounds stupid, and maybe it is, but it's fun. Elias is a very good farmer, I have to say, but he's not the best processor. So one of the things that I wanted to help him with was to streamline his coffee process so that he doesn't over-ferment or over-dry the coffee. Another issue in Colombia is leaf rust. I don't know if you know what it is, but leaf rust is the fungus, the orange one here. Looks a little rusty, that attacks coffee plants. And what basically happens, you kill the leaves. So when it rains, instead of the coffee tree giving more flowers and cherries, it gives new leaves. Because without leaves, it's not able to do photosynthesis. It's a big problem in Colombia, and a big part of it is because of a lot of rain. But I also think there's too much monoculture, and they plant the trees very close to each other, so it's easier for the leaf rust to spread. Like in Kenya, they're doing pruning techniques that minimizes leaf rust, even without spraying copper. This is the neighboring farm of Elias, and the reason why there are coffee trees with no leaves is because of leaf rust. And in Pital, in the mountain range there, we saw a lot of this year. There was literally no coffee there. This is Elias's farm. There's a little bit of difference, huh? And that's why I'm saying he's a good farmer. He knows how to take care of the trees, which is the most important thing. So, I came to the farm, you know, I think I know everything. And I was supposed to be at the farm for 3 weeks in June, and at the end of June I was going to learn Spanish, you know, go out with the Colombian girls. And then Elias called me, I was in Korea or something, and he called me and said, like, you have to come now, the harvest is early. So I had to change my tickets and go to the farm, and I only had 4 days because I have some commitments in Norway. So I had 4 days to work on the farm. So I just, okay, what do we do? I had to write a plan. What do we do in 4 days in order to change literally everything on the farm? And the rule number one, if you want to change something on a farm, if you want any farmer to do any experiment for you, you have to commit to buying the coffee. You can't just ask them to do this with the coffee and I might buy it if it tastes good. You have to buy it. And whether or not you can sell it, that's your problem. But if you want people to spend a lot of money on changing something, you have to commit. And I think that's why Elias decided to work with me, because I'm willing to risk that money to and commit to that coffee. Because how bad can the coffee be? I mean, if I control the process and everything, at least it won't be over-fermented. And okay, it might not be the best coffee in the world right now, but I'll be able to sell it for at least some of the cost of production. So the market price today is around 1.95 in Colombia per pound. So I committed to paying $3.50 for the coffee and to do all the improvements. And I would buy all the coffee that we processed if it was within the moisture content that we set and certain parameters. And Elias agreed to do this. We don't write a contract. I wrote him like an outline of what I wanted to do, and we agree face to face. I don't think we need to write contracts. I mean, it's a matter of trust. One of the first things he did was separating his farms into different sections. For me, this is interesting because we're streamlining the process and everything, but now we can start researching if the south side of the hill produces better coffee than the north side and so on. It's a matter of sun exposure and so on, and in wine, I mean, this is normal, but in coffee, it's not very normal. I know some farms who do it, but this is crucial to separate the lots in order to be able to research it. He has Caturas, which everyone thinks is the best variety in Colombia. We had a cupping 2 days ago that was a little different because the Colombia variety, which is considered an inferior variety, actually tasted better 2 days ago from the same farm. So he has Colombia variety as well. He's planting some Castillo, which is an improvement of the Colombia variety. Colombia variety is Catura and Hibrido de Timor crossing. So people are afraid of the Timor thing. After sectioning the farm, which is quite easy, you just measure with tape and put some signs up, we had to start improving the picking. Because we all know that coffee, the best coffee, is done by selective picking, right? Well, that's not always the case. Because just because people are picking the coffee manually doesn't mean they're doing a good job. Normally, you can see pictures like this, and it looks beautiful, right? Only red cherries. But if you start researching what's in that bucket, this is what you find. You find the majority is red. You find some that is on the edge of being overmature, can sometimes be fermented if it's too moist. You find a lot of semi-ripe, and you can find some black beans and also green. I mean, if you make a coffee out of this, most likely it won't taste very clean and very ripe, right? When you go to the coffee trees, some trees look like this. It's easy to pick. Other trees look like this. It's a nightmare to pick. I was picking myself, and a lot of times when you pick this red and you turn the cherry around, there's green on the other side. That's why you get all the semi-ripes. It's really, really difficult to pick coffee. So I had a meeting with the pickers. This was Sunday, so it was their day off. They were a little bit grumpy already. They never met me before. And all of a sudden, I asked them to do a better job. And we promised them a lot more money for it. So they seem to be quite positive. But, everyone is skeptical to change. The only guy that was 100% positive from the very start was actually the oldest guy, which I didn't expect at all. I thought it would be the hardest nut to crack. So we had a meeting. We talked about why do we have to change? Because they need a better salary. Elias needs to make money in order to pay them better salary. And I need better coffee. Very simple and easy. And the principle is we need to take care of the picking. So after some meetings and adjustments and some calculation on their average picking and so on and what we got in, we actually increased the salary of the picker with 52%. We paid 52% more per arroba, which is 12 and a half kilos of cherry. So it's a bucket of cherry. And if you calculate how much less they pick because they're more picky, they pick about 25 kilos less in a day. Normally they can pick around 100 kilos. Now they pick 75 maybe. So that means around 21-22% increase in salary. Some of the pickers were actually picking as fast as they normally did. And other pickers were really, really thorough, so they were picking much less. So we were monitoring every day with spreadsheets how much they, on average, had been picking before and how much they were picking now. And we were sort of talking with every picker, like, you need to pick a little bit faster, or you need to, you know, be more thorough with your selection, which worked quite well, I have to say. Educating them on what to pick, so only pick the red, not the green, not the semi-ripe, and also, most importantly, don't throw the greens and stuff on the ground, which was really hard for them not to do, because it takes time to, you know, you have to pick it sometimes. You have to pick the blacks, otherwise they will just fall to the ground anyway, and you will have problems with broca and all sorts of things. I picked myself. This is a result from 2 hours of picking. I was quite proud of that. They would have at least two, maybe three. So in 2 hours, I picked 10 kilos of cherries, which is about 1.3 kilos of roasted coffee. And a normal picker would probably pick twice as much on an average. Depends a little bit on where you are in the picking season. I forced them to sit on the ground afterwards and sort out all the greens and overripes, which was really hard to get them to do. Because, first of all, they pick from 6 in the morning till 8, and then they go in, weigh the coffee, then they won't have breakfast, and just run out to the field to pick more, because they're paid by the weight. So wasting time on this, either they can't eat breakfast, or they lose time in the field picking. It helped a little bit, but we really needed to supervise. Like Elias, I had to train Elias to be a boss. Like, he had to tell them, like, this is not good enough. I'm paying you more, you have to do better. This is actually really hard, because everyone lives on the farm, and it's hard to sort of, you're sort of friends, and, you know, it's difficult. This is the selection after 2 days, so I think it improved a lot. Remember the last picture with a lot of overripes and stuff? So this was pretty good, I think. One of the things that I found hard when I picked was you have to pick some green sometimes. You have to pick some of the blacks. And what do you do with it? You can't throw it on the ground. You can't put it in the bucket. So I put it in my back pocket. And after a while, you know. So one of the guys, in the next morning, he had put a Coke bottle, put all the overripes and green there, which was very efficient. Some of the guys used bags, but you have to open the bag, and, you know, it takes a long time. So the Coke bottle actually really helped with the efficiency. So I bought a case of Coke, and we just chopped off the necks, and of course we drank the Coke. And then every picker got this, which really improved the cherry selection, and they could spend less time on the ground sorting afterwards. One of the things that we also found was that we had to pay for the bad cherry as well, for the same price as the good cherry. So when you weigh coffee, you have the one bag with the red cherry and the ripe, and then you have the second bag that you put on top with the overripe and green. Because if you don't pay for it, the pickers are going to throw it on the ground. Because, you know, it's easier. And that seemed to be very efficient as well. And most of the pickers, after 4 days, were very happy. There was one picker that was not happy at all, although he made a lot more money. So Elias fired him. It's like, dude, what can you do? This is the rejected cherry. And probably that will be sold on the internal market or something like that. Do you think so? Yeah. So after spending a lot of time improving picking, you have to improve the process as well. And one of the first things that I noticed was that the wet mill itself was filthy. Like, if you look at this picture, it looks reasonably clean, right? It's always like that. But if you start digging into details, you always find, like, it's super dirty. Because the farmers don't have time to clean it, you know, they have to pick, they have to dry, they have to do a lot of things. So they don't really think about this. They clean it before the season, and they clean it maybe every once in a while on a Sunday, and then that's it. So I bought new boots for Edilson, clean boots, white boots, so we could use to walk inside the mill, because they were all getting dirty because they had a lot of soil on the shoes when they entered the wet mill. This was inside the depulper. You remember the Kenyan coffee number 2 we cupped yesterday? That's how this smelled like. I took my finger in and it was like manure, literally manure. So I asked them to clean it, and of course Elias was ashamed that it was so dirty, and this is the result afterwards. This is just scraped metal, so it's actually clean. So he had made a cherry hopper with stainless steel, so it's easier to clean. Actually, I asked him to do fermentation tanks in stainless steel, but you know, cherry hoppers, fermentation tank, doesn't matter. But it's a lot easier to clean, and there's a lot of soil and dirt here as well. I noticed that he was, when I arrived, he was depulping coffee in the morning, he was depulping coffee in the after lunch, and he was depulping coffee in the evening. He mixed everything together, fermented it together, and of course, you're going to get a very uneven result from fermenting three different products. So I logged the temperature of the cherry in the cherry receiving tank, and the highest temperature we got was 24 degrees, which is not very, for me, not very dangerous in terms of fermenting the coffee. So we decided instead of doing three depulpings per day, we are just going to do one in the evening. So here we're depulping. And we're fermenting in like with no water, dry fermentation. Takes about 16 hours. Can take shorter because of the weather. It might be very hot. But in order not to over ferment it, we implemented a mid-rinse like they do in Kenya a lot. You ferment the coffee for a while, you rinse it with water, and it continue to ferment until the coffee is ready. And then you have a much lower risk of over fermenting the coffee. After fermentation, cleaning, they don't have washing channels, so you got to do it in the tank. It's really, really hard work, and very, very stressful for the back. And of course, removing the floaters, you have to do that. They didn't do that before. These are floaters from one picking. They're getting sold as pasillas, but normally this would come with a normal parchment. After the washing, I decided to implement a soak, like they do in Kenya and Ethiopia. And the reason for it is because when you're picking a lot of different maturation stages. It's not like every single bean is the same. So the theory is that, and I haven't been able to measure it because my moisture meter doesn't measure high enough moisture content, but the theory is that this will even out the moisture content in the beans, so it's easier to dry more evenly. Get it? Simple and easy. There might be some other stuff going on, I don't know, I'm not a scientist. But we find that the coffees from Kenya and Ethiopia are normally very uniform, and they don't age very fast. They tend to stay fresh for longer. So we implemented a soak, 24 hours, we changed the water 2 or 3 times a day, depending. And then, of course, what I talked about earlier, improving the drying. Because in Colombia, it rains pretty much every day, so everyone is using the dryers with the plastic cover. And one of the issues with Colombian coffees, and I think I speak for most roasters, is that it's risky to buy because they age fast. Yeah, this is 40 degrees on the parchment. It's way too high to dry coffee. And that's just on a random day that wasn't particularly hot. I asked Elias to build a couple of small, simple wooden boxes, like with nets, so we could experiment with raised beds. But he decides to hire this guy and build a whole platform of stainless steel raised beds that costs $1 million, you know? So it's not that the guy is not committed, you know? But they weren't finished, so we couldn't use them. So we had to improve what was already there. And the first thing we did was to open up the sides of the dryers in order to get ventilation, because it's extremely humid in there. So just by opening the sides where the wind is coming in, you get rid of all the humidity. We put up shades. This is the net that you use for nurseries where you grow plants. We put up that. So we were able to lower the temperature with over 10 degrees just by putting up some shades. And now the temperature of the parchment was between 20 and 30 degrees, which is much, much better. The only downfall with this is that the drying time went from 6 days to about 28 days, which means a lot more work and you need a lot more space. But from what I hear, Elias has continued doing this, although it's a big headache for him. Of course, this guy has to move the coffee all the time. We started marking every day. We picked separate lots. So one day we pick Katura lot number 5, the other day the Colombia lot number 10, and so on. And we wrote down how many hours in the fermentation tank, how many hours of soaking, and so on. And of course, this label is coming all the way to Norway when I get the samples. So we can take out the bad lots, if there are any, if he overdries it or something like that. And also start understanding which coffees are actually the better ones. So this is a picture of the old process. This is the new process. So this coffee was processing the week before I came. Looked dirty, parchment was cracked. You're gonna taste it afterwards. And this is a coffee from the new process. Smells sweet and green, like lush, like when you smell plants. And very little cracked parchment. A lot of people say that fading has something to do with storage, and I don't disagree. I just don't think it's as important as the drying. But there's a warehouse very close to the farm, a small warehouse, in an extremely hot city or town. And we went to the warehouse, and the parchment itself was stored at almost 32 degrees. And it wasn't a particularly hot day. So, you know, you do all this work, you can't ruin the coffee in the storage. So I had to make Elias drive to Garçon, which is a 2-hour drive, deliver the coffee there to be stored there. You can store it on the farm because the altitude is quite high, but there's a limited amount of space and it's not as safe as storing it in the warehouse. So in Garçon, the temperature is around 26, 27, when it was 32 in the other place. So now all the coffee is stored there. And this is the Coop Central, is the cooperative that is helping him doing this, because it's extremely important to have a partner that is willing to help. If you don't have that, you know, the farmers are on their own. So Coop Central is not only doing the storage, which they really don't have space for, and you know, it's a headache for them as well. But they're storing all the lots separately in different bags and keeping track of it. They're preparing samples for me to taste, giving me all the information, logging, and most importantly, they're pre-financing Elias's coffee. Because normally, Elias would harvest the coffee, dry the coffee, sell the coffee, get money straight away. Now he has to harvest the coffee, dry it for a month, store the coffee, wait until I've tasted the samples, then I buy the coffee, and then a month later he gets the money. So Coop Central, I had a meeting with them. They said they were willing to pay for his coffee the market price for that day. So when he delivers the coffee, he will at least get the normal amount of money. The problem is his cost is much higher now because he's paying the pickers more, he's paying a dryer for a longer time, and so on. Exporter. You need to have a good exporter because the cooperative is not allowed to send samples because Colombia has some issues with some other produce that they are famous for. So you need to have a good exporter. This guy here, Alejandro, is helping me to do a... Not only sending samples and making sure the coffee is milled right, but communicating. I don't know Spanish yet, so I have to send emails to Alejandro, long emails, and he has to translate, you know, and he has to translate Elias's emails to me, and so on. I use Google Translate sometimes, but if you have a lot of coffee language, you would be surprised how different the sentence can be. And of course also pre-financing the coffee when it's shipped and so on. You need an exporter for that. And sometimes if you get trouble with the police, he has to pay drivers and you know, make bail and get you out of prison.
Only once.
Only once, so far. So let's just, I'm going to show you a video soon, but let's look a little bit on the finance of this, because we all claim to be selling quality, we all claim to be paying more, but we need to understand that this is a lot of extra work, and still if we pay almost twice the amount of the market price, it's coffee is extremely cheap. The New York City yesterday was about 175, that's 175 cents per pound. And FNC gives like a 20 cent differential, so plus because of the quality, or I don't understand, but they have an extra price. Yeah. My price, I promised him $3.50 for a pound, which, you know, sounds like a high price, but you need to calculate the cost as well. If the cost is much higher, it might be a very bad price. So this was sort of the promise, and then we had to look at the cost and everything. Additional production costs just on the farm, with the paying the pickers more and longer drying, is about 35 cents per pound. So it was actually a little bit lower than I expected, which is good. And then you have the exporters and the millers who, you know, when you have 20 different lots of 5 bags here and 2 bags there, there's a lot of extra work. So they have to charge more. It takes a lot more time to mill and so on. Normally, I think the exporter maybe take like 30 cents on like bulk coffee, is that right? And on like micro lots, it's a little bit more. So if you just think about it, if you say, okay, the market price is 175 plus the differential, so 195, and then you might think like, I'm paying $2.50, that's a fantastic price, you know? It's so much higher than the market price. And you look at the extra cost for actually doing an effort, it's a terrible price. Yet we walk around in our in Norway and like, yeah, we pay a lot for coffee. It's like, no, you don't. You pay a lousy salary for these workers. And you might not even be paying for extra quality. You're buying a lot that randomly happens to be a little bit better than the rest. So, old production cost of the coffee is around 122 cents. The market price 190 cents something. And margin that the farmer makes is about 50 cents. The new production cost was around 157 cents, and the new total margin after deducting all the exporters and, 127 cents per pound, which for us doesn't seem like a lot of money, but when you sell a container of coffee, then it starts to be a good price for a farmer. This makes Elias able to invest in a little bit better equipment. We're going to install an aqua pulper, or a mechanical mucilage remover, in order to save water. I want to implement water filtration, so we don't pollute the drinking water. Drying facilities, maybe experimenting with new varieties, experimenting with some organic fertilizer, and so on. And I think in order to do all this, we have to even pay a higher price. But you have to start somewhere, and to be honest, the coffees are not a Cup of Excellence winners yet, but you have to start somewhere. So 249% increase in margin. That's pretty good, I think. So in my opinion, as I opened, we've sort of fixed the base issues, the drying, the processing, the picking. For me now, the real quality work can start. I can start working in the field where the quality is actually happening. It takes 9 months to grow coffee. There's a lot of issues during those 9 months, and it takes about 2 to 3 weeks to ruin the coffee normally in the process. If you're not ruining the coffee in the process, then you can start actually tasting difference from the south side of a hill, north side of a hill, different soils, different varieties, different pruning techniques, different picking techniques, I don't know. There's a lot of things that I have in mind that I want to try. You need to pay more, and you need to streamline. That's what you have to do in order to do this. So I'm just going to show you a little video from the whole project.
¿Cuántos faltan? ¿Cuántos faltan?
Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. Yeah, let's go to the cupping.